Hello there, and welcome to yet another episode of The Checkpoint. My name is Lynn Komjisha. Tonight, I'm very privileged to host Ms. Elizabeth Mushabe, UN Women Program Specialist on Leaving No One Behind. Take note of that, leaving no one behind, because we're not leaving you tonight anywhere behind us, right? So join us today and let us see what we are the good things that she has packaged for us. We are looking at gender inequality, violence, HIV and COVID-19. Now, if you have been following the news, you have seen that UN Women has been behind the 16 days of activism. If you have followed that, thank you. If you haven't, we have you tonight. Don't worry, we're going to keep you updated. Now, we are looking at strengthening national commitment and action towards improving girls' and women's access to formal and informal education in particular. Keeping girls enrolled through primary and secondary education should be strongly supported as part of overall anti-violence efforts. Now, this was a comment by UN Women at the launch of the 16 Days of Activism. Ms. Elizabeth, welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me.
How are you?
Fine.
COVID-19 has taught us a number of things. Prevention and response is critical, and that, alongside COVID pandemic, another pandemic that is gender-based violence, is at a magnitude. Let's start from there.
Yes, I like your observation that gender-based violence is shooting up. I think we need to be reminded of the fact that gender-based violence has been here. What COVID-19 has done to us is to help us bring it to the fore. It has underlined the voices that have been shouting out loud for us to be able to address gender-based violence globally, but also coming back home in Uganda. It is true, gender-based violence is on the rise because we've now seen it. We've witnessed it manifest in many ways. Women, children, men are crying out loud. They need assistance.
Now, where is the intersection between gender inequalities, sexual and gender-based violence, take note, also HIV?
I want to say that the intersection should have been obvious to all of us by now. Because what several years of research and programming have shown us is that people who are exposed to violence, it could be from an intimate partner, it could be from a guardian, it could be from a caretaker, they have higher chances of contracting HIV. We have also seen in the population-based surveys quite a big proportion of people, normally younger people and women, reporting having experienced violent episodes or events in their lives. And when you go to the communities of people living with HIV, the numbers are even higher. And they actually tell you that, look, I either left a violent relationship, went into another, maybe I ran out of home for what I could not stand, and the exposure and risk to HIV there is heightened. So the association is really not a causality relationship, but there is that linkage, close linkage, in terms of what you're exposed to, your way of life, and how vulnerable you will be to acquiring an HIV infection. We are also seeing a number of inequalities. If you look, for instance, at people living with HIV and ask, are you embarrassed? Are you ashamed? Do you fear speaking about your HIV status? Clearly, they will tell you yes, and you have about 4 in every 10 persons living with HIV still regretting why they have HIV, and they feel bad. That already shows you that the terrain is not level, and it shows you that there is stigma. There is some level of discrimination they experience, and they wouldn't want to easily talk about their HIV status. That in itself is an inequality. The most famous one, poverty. Poverty, if you look at it from a per capita point of view, you realize that many persons living with HIV have high needs in terms of financial support, while treatment may be free, while the HIV test may be free, accessing it, going to where it is given requires some money for transport. Taking that pill requires food, and they don't have ready sources of income, and that limits their adherence. Now, a limitation in adherence is a limitation in several other spaces of preventing HIV or of living with HIV. It becomes very difficult for you to eat medicine without food. You can't have food unless you have bought it and prepared it and the right food balanced for you to be fine and virally suppressed. So the inequalities are really high. We also have gender-based violence that you talked about, manifesting in several forms, but usually we see two. We see the sexual gender-based violence as the most leading and disturbing inequality in this case, and mental or psychosocial disturbances. People have a lot they think about and need support. Support they can get from family, from peers, but these systems are not functioning and they don't get the support they need. So the inequalities that we see and that I want to agree with you that we should attend to are high up there, and they increase or make it fertile for HIV to thrive in a space where they are not attended to as priority.
Absolutely, absolutely, I agree with you. But Ms. Elizabeth, if we can remember, growing up, there were myths around sexual and gender-based violence, that if your man does not beat you, then he doesn't love you. If your man is not aggressive, then he has no love or respect for you. We have also seen that many women will not fight back, or many men will not fight back. They would rather sit down. How is UN Women, especially because this is part of your programs, how are you addressing the myths? How are you tackling these myths that surround, even in urban areas? You'll be shocked when a woman will say, if my husband doesn't beat me, then I think I doubt his love for me.
Yeah, I think it has moved from even being just a myth. It's now fact documented that women, we have 5 in 10 who are comfortable to be beaten or spanked for some reason. And men are also saying, yeah, if I don't do it, my woman will not be happy with me. It's documented. It's no longer myth. And as UN Women, we are concerned that this kind of attitude prevails in our societies. Recently, we did, with support of the Ministry of Gender and UBOS, there was a violence survey done, and preliminary results show us that this attitude varies across regions. We have it still high up to about 5 in 10 in the Bukedi region. There you have Tororo and the regions around Tororo. And then it goes on reducing, of course, varying, as I said. When you come to South Buganda, you have maybe 1 or 2 in every 10 saying, it's okay to beat me. So why we have such campaigns like 16 Days of Activism is to point out some of those persisting attitudes in communities, to say your men can show you love in other ways rather than beating you up. Beating you up is not the only way that they can show you love. Let's not promote that. It's not nice. It's not good for your body. It's not good for your mental development. It's not good for your physical activity. It's not good for you. You can be loved. We've seen people sharing flowers. Can he give you a flower to show you he loves you? Can he make sure the family is provided for, show you he loves you? Can you also not disturb? Can you also do what you think you can do as a woman, so that then he sees there's no reason even to beat you up? So it's through awareness raising, through talking about alternative ways of expressing love and cordial living together and relationships. It is through empowerment, where we say, women, take it upon yourself to know your environment and take informed decisions and share with your men and your partners and your family members. You don't need to entertain a beating.
I know.
For as an expression of love. So,
or emotional.
It is really out of talking and pointing out alternatives to those ways through which women used to think they were loved. Because, I mean, if they beat you, then you thought they cared. Mm-hmm. After all, they have noticed that you went away and came back late. So then he should quarrel a bit and say, and then I know he missed me.
Oh.
So this has now changed. The world has moved. Yeah. And we are lucky that many civil society movements are coming up to say no to some of these practices and cultures that put our women to stress.
Absolutely. Yes. Now, UN Women during the 14th annual Joint AIDS Review said that they're drawing our attention to the National Investment Plan that recommends a prioritized scale-up plan where new HIV infections are projected to decline and reach 15,000 by 2025, while AIDS-related death will decline to 10,800. Now, in that regard, also the executive director, UNAIDS, Winnie Byanyima, said AIDS remains a pandemic, the red light to flashing, and only by moving fast to end the inequalities that drive the pandemic can we overcome it. There has been talk that Uganda has done well, not just mere talk. Reports indicate that we are doing well via dealing with HIV/AIDS. UN Women and HIV/AIDS, sexual gender-based violence, how would you rate yourself?
I would agree with those who think we are doing well, because yes, we are. A few years ago, if you want 5 years ago, you would not relate HIV with sexual gender-based violence. You would not relate HIV with keeping girls in school. You would not relate HIV with the key populations, like we have a lot of women in sex work, and it is a sure way of exposing oneself to an HIV infection if it is done without protection. And today we are at another level where we actually can speak of what we are doing to reduce those exposures, to reduce those risks that expose people, women, girls, and boys to HIV, even children unborn or breastfeeding. There is so much going on. So I think when the executive director, Winnie, says that it's attainable, I think she's right. But also speaking from the point of view of the role we see communities affected and at high risk of HIV play, they have come out to speak against HIV. And they are saying it's uncomfortable here where we are at. It's not very comfortable that you live with an HIV infection. There is a way you must adjust your life to come back to normalcy and continue. So these communities, I think, need to be elevated to another level so they can tell us more of their experiences and point us to where we need to increase our efforts. You will take communities of women living with HIV, young people living with HIV, sex, women and men in sex work. These have lived experiences and testimonies that me and you speaking about HIV don't know. Now, if you listened to them a day or two, you would then understand that when I'm saying that you need to take your medication on time, yet you work here, this is Naguru, and you work in Nansana, and your pill stays here, and you must take it 7 o'clock every evening, it's possible that you'll be stuck in jam. So please do not say things that are not putting the contexts in perspective. First understand the context. First understand the experiences we go through, and then recommend how we can best partner to make sure that I contain my HIV virus down so I don't transmit to others around me as I interact with them. So it's attainable, but the voices of the communities and experiences lived must be elevated to another level. I want to speak to a very exciting example with young people. We had a situation where we had a generation of young people born with HIV getting worried of how they will start to disclose to their partners, to their peers, to their trainers, their employers. But there is a section of them that said, no, we'll do it with you. We'll overcome the stigma. We'll overcome the shame of knowing that I'm HIV positive. The finger pointing that we go through every day on the streets. And this team is organized under an umbrella organization called Uganda Network of Young People Living with HIV. What they did was an idea that started with a single lady, Alessi Jacqueline, who has long left the organization. And she said, we will model beauty with HIV. Model beauty with HIV, meaning I have overcome the HIV infection. I have suppressed the AIDS. It won't manifest in me. And I can show you that I can do as well as anybody else out there who knows or doesn't know about their HIV status. And to an extent, even better. So I'll be a beauty queen. So they introduced this pageant, which has seen thousands of young people coming out, stepping forward and saying, I have HIV, I got it the way I got it, but it doesn't define me. And I think for me, that's the attitude. If you're going to overcome any inequality, any circumstance, any condition in your life, that's the attitude we need to promote.
That's right. Now, sexual and reproductive health challenges, poverty, climate change, COVID-19 now, 2 years, HIV still pose a great threat to women and girls. How can we create safe spaces for women and girls, you know, facing these problems and also avoiding furthering these, you know, problems?
Yeah, I'll start with poverty. I think as we grew up with HIV, we saw HIV being an issue of class, economic class. But as years go by, we realize that when you have some stable income or you have some resources, you can easily balance out your life. You can have some food, you can live well, you can schedule your work, you can do all these things and your life will stay stable, standard and fair. So you can even postpone an infection or you can live minimally comfortable with an infection. We are also seeing that HIV, I think the other day at Kololo, His Excellency said that for him to be first introduced to HIV, he knew it was a disease of a certain category of people. And as days went by, he realized that anyone else can get it. But that certain category of people were people struggling to make ends meet. And yes, they were dealing with poverty. So the interactions and the relationships there are really complex. You have situations where the epidemic has shifted from the rich and well-to-do to those that are struggling for survival and those that are actually coming up or mushrooming to live their full potential and be grown or senior adults. And it moves now to what you're calling a sexual reproductive health. And it talks a lot to your ability and understanding of your body, bodily autonomy. We have a generation that have not been assisted in any way to understand their body as they are growing up. We have had, if I come very close to where we are at, 2 years of lockdown, of no speech, of closing you up with people that you have always feared. You're looking for this holiday to end and you run back to school. There, at least you have some breather. Now you are locked up with your mom, with your dad in the same house. You have no peers to talk to. Your siblings are what they are. They've been looking up to you as a senior or probably as a minor and are saying, what does she know? What does he know? He doesn't know anything. So it's a whole issue of complex matters. And sexuality in this country is perceived differently, so it affects how our younger generation takes it up. And this we have seen not being made better by the lockdown and the disruption in services, or people that have been telling us about these things without fear, having been locked out of reach from us. It has also even come to manifest in not very kind means of the 10 pregnancies. It's something in our face, and clearly it shows you that young boys and girls out there are sexually active. Sexually active, and I hasten to say, in a careless manner. While you see the pregnancy, several other things have happened. There could be an HIV infection in there. There could be an STI, sexually transmitted infection. There could have even been an abortion. This pregnancy that has mushroomed could be a third one. Because pregnancy takes is potential every month. So month one, what happened? Month two, what happened? We are in month 21. You don't know how many abortions have happened. But all this is because we are not clear on the package of information, services, and assistance we can give to our generation, the younger ones. It's tough. It's a policy matter. It's a service matter. It's a behavior matter, it's an attitude matter, and it zeroes down to the family. It's a responsibility matter. It's complex. That is what I can say about sexual reproductive health. If you want me to speak about COVID-19, what research is showing us is also scary. A study done in 2020, by WHO, did show some interesting statistics. They looked at about 1,500 hospital admissions related to COVID, and these were all people living with HIV. And the discovery or the data that they share shows that about 13% of those admissions were likely to present with severe COVID symptoms. And when I say severe symptoms, you understand what I mean in terms of COVID. And there was also a 30% risk of death for those admissions. And these are people living with HIV. And a report released on 1st of December by UNAIDS confirms it. They said that HIV as a comorbidity with COVID-19 heightens the risk of severe symptoms, but also the risk of death. And so COVID and HIV are not something we should allow to coexist in one individual. And I think that underscores the reason we are talking about COVID-19 now, and specifically looking at communities of people living with HIV as a potential ground for disaster. We don't want that to happen. We need to step up the vaccination efforts. We need to step up the information giving and assistance to persons living with HIV so that COVID-19 does not penetrate those communities, because then we are headed for disaster if that happens.
That's right. Mm-hmm. Wow, wonderful. Very scary statistics there. Worrying, I should
Very
say.
Very worrying. Mm-hmm.
Right, I like that you mentioned sexuality, sexual reproductive health, and our girls, we have seen that during the 2 years of lockdown, things have been ugly. Adolescent girls and young women remain a population of concern in terms of absolute infections and inequalities, some of which you have highlighted, that hinder adaptation of HIV, preventive behaviors, and effective survival with HIV infections. Now, we noticed that during this period, over 90,000 young girls got pregnant. The girl, that actually is very painful. And poor girls searched for means of survival. That is the excuse they give. That you see, things got hard, so for some reason, Uncle so-and-so was able to, chip in on grounds that I, let him in. What is the UN Women doing to reduce the consequences this presents and ensuring fairness to the affected children?
Yes, thank you for asking that question. Primarily, UN Women exists for the promotion of gender equality and empowerment of women and girls. Primarily, that's what we exist for. And at the center of our work is the daunting task of supporting actors in that space of gender equality and empowerment of girls to pay attention to the inherent biases that predispose women and girls to inequality, limit their access to services, but also as you look at the 90,000 girls, what are policymakers and development practitioners doing to make sure that some of these biases, some of these policies that are biased and prejudiced to some cultures are actually attended to and begin to improve? I don't want to say reform, but begin to improve. Because for policy to be affected, the circumstances demand so. Now circumstances have changed. Is it possible to look at what is happening? And so as an organization working with others, what we did, I can say, was first of all to reactivate, of course, mobilize civil society, the UN colleagues and other development partners, to reactivate the debate around supporting adolescent girls to be able to understand their body as it develops, but also to be able to say no, speak up. You know, in a family where you have more than one child, the one that doesn't speak up normally takes the blame all the time. You ask, who did this? It's her. Who did this? It's her. Then you ask her, what happened? Instead, she's crying. Instead of telling you what actually happened. So we are saying, speak up. Be on alert all the time. And see, be able to sense the dangers around you. So to be back on point, I want to allude to two programs that we have initiated close to the COVID lockdown onset and pushed through the lockdown until today and maybe after today. One of them is the Second Chance Education Program that you had our county representative in charge talk to on 16 Days of Activism. They must have showcased a few girls that have broken the ceiling, that have gone through the odds of COVID-19 and attained some form of learning and skilling, and they are using that to survive. Now, what this program does is to speak to the constraints and barriers before the school setting that might keep this girl out of the school or the learning institution. Things around you are a child mother. You can't go to school. You're already someone's wife. Who can teach someone's wife? Those things that happen in the community. You also think you got pregnant. If you go to school, even in a place where people don't know you, you think they know she was pregnant the other day and now she's in uniform. Look at her. All that has to be dealt away with. So our Second Chance Education Program attends mainly to those community level, family and personal barriers that may hinder you from enrolling into a learning program and completing with excellent outcomes. The second thing that we also do is, and this program first runs in about 18 districts, in Karamoja, Bukedi, Teso, Lango, and West Nile. The other thing that we do is create for those that cannot really, really, really go back to school or even start to learn maybe plumbing, technical drawing or anything, we encourage them to learn at least to read and write, support them to start saving schemes and start an enterprise of your own so that you have a source of income. Now, many people, when they get money, a lot of the challenges they've had around decision-making become easier, become no challenges. So we thought and did research and understood our programs from that point of view that if women get money in their hands, they will actually overcome many obstacles. And so those that cannot really go back for learning or school, we have what we call power rights clubs. This is something we have done in West Nile, in the four districts of West Nile, and we are seeing great results. We are seeing young mothers that are coming back, learning to write their names, learning to add up their small enterprise sales on a day, offset with the expenditure, what they made as profit is now clear to them, and what else they can do with that that they think is profit. In their perspective is put down. So those power rights clubs are more safe spaces for them that they will share. Mine didn't work out. Yours didn't work out. But hers worked out. How did she do it? And they exchange like that. And the mushrooming attitudes that we see are now of like, I don't need to stick to a man who doesn't actually like me and makes me cry every day, but I can live my life and I'll choose which man. Now, choice in terms of sexuality is important, be it for men, be it for women. If you can choose your own sexual partner, that is the first step to success. Because if there are any things you don't like about him, you won't go there. But when you can't make that choice and that decision to choose, it's difficult. Anyone that comes your way, you will say, ah, today I am lucky, someone talked about me. And you think that that's the best when it's not actually the best for you. So these are two programs that we think, if brought to scale, they can give us the impact we want to see in terms of changing attitudes, in terms of empowering and helping young women and girls understand their body and make the right decisions and choices.
Wonderful, wonderful. I like the idea of women and money, their money. A woman has to have some kamani of them for yourself. Your own money. One, you can say, I made my own money. We'll have more on that conversation right after the break.